Hello, it's Carly McAvoy talking about probability. In the last video, we talked about an event being something that could happen during an experiment or a trial. And now I want to talk about the complement of an event. So if we have event A, the complement is denoted by A bar, the bar above that. And so that consists of all the outcomes in which event A does not occur. So if a coin landing heads up is event A, then the complement of A is the coin landing tails up. So a complement is anything that's happening that's outside of our initial event. So tails and heads are complementary events. Another example, event A is rolling a 1 on a 6-sided die. Well, the probability of rolling a 1, there's 1 chance out of 6 that you could do that. So 1 divided by 6, which is approximately 0.167, rounding our probabilities to 3 decimal places. So the event, the complement of A, is not rolling a 1. And so we could get that a few different ways. One way we could do it then is just say, well, if rolling an A is 1/6, if I take 1 and subtract the probability of getting a 1, what's left is a probability of not getting a 1. The other way to think about that would be to say, if there's 1 chance that I will roll a 1, how many chances are there that I will not roll a 1? And that's 5. And if you take 5 divided by 6, you'll get 0.833. So you can subtract from 100% from what you know is your event A to find out what the complement would be. Or you could actually just do the calculation separately. So if you are given a percent, make sure to change it to a decimal number first. For instance, if this was 16.7%, I would move it over to, right, to change from a percent to a decimal and then subtract from 1. Okay, so that's the complement of an event and how to find that complement if you know the probability of the complement, if you know the probability of the event itself. Okay. Now I want to talk about another thing that we frequently talk about when we're talking about statistics, and it's things like this one is, what are the chances of a woman having at least one girl if she has 3 children? So when we say at least one girl, we mean she could have 1 or 2 or 3. At least one doesn't limit it. It just says there is at least one, right? Another way we could say something different is if we say exactly one boy, then it could only be the boy has to be, there just has to be one of them. How many ways could she have one boy if she had 3 children? How many ways could she have at least one girl? Those are very different things, right? So you have to read to say, are they saying at least one, at most one, or exactly one? Those are 3 different things. In order to figure this out, you have to know what the sample space is. And so if we're talking about 3 children, somebody could have girl followed by 2 girls, girl followed by a girl and a boy, girl followed by a boy and a girl, girl followed by 2 boys. And then basically you repeat the same thing for boys. I'm going from the bottom up, 3 boys, boy, boy, girl, boy, girl, boy, and boy, girl, girl. So you could come up with that systematic list, and there's a tree diagram you can use to do that. But for now, take my word for it. There's 8 different outcomes when you have 3 children. And if you're talking about the chance of having at least one girl, that means that you're looking for everything where there's at least one girl. And if you look starting with 7 and 6 and 5 and 4 and 3 and 2 and 1, all of these have at least one girl. There's either one girl or 2 girls or 3 girls, which is fine. So that means there's only one time in when you out of 8 when you have 3 children that you have all boys. And so the chance of having at least one girl is 7 times out of 8 you'll have at least one girl. And that is 0.875. as a probability. And what we're saying here is that the girls are greater than or equal to 1. In other words, there's at least 1 in there. The different problem that we had here was, what if we wanted to know how often can she have exactly one boy? Well, if you look at this, number 2, she has one boy. Number 3, she has one boy. And number 5, she has one boy. So there's 3 different ways in this 8 set that she could have one boy. And so if boys equal 1, there's 3 out of 8, or 0.375. So there's more questions you can ask about that. Just be careful about what they're actually asking, but know what your sample space is to begin with. And so I will just tell you a nice little hint. When there are only two outcomes, like we had here, either boys or girls, then it could, to find the size of your sample space, when there's two outcomes, you just take 2 to the power of the number of trials that there are. So in the example above, we had 2 outcomes and we had 3 children. So 2 to the third power means that we had 8 outcomes. If you had 4 children, you'd have 2 to the fourth or 16 different outcomes. And that number, of course, gets bigger and bigger as you have more and more children. So knowing that is a nice little way to know what the size of your sample space. But if you're going to ask this kind of question, you need to know more than just knowing the number. You have to be able to look at how that breakdown looks, right? This would be very similar if we were asking heads or tails. We would say it could be 3 heads, it could be heads, heads, tails, right? Anything where there's 2 outcomes, then we can break it down and look at that list pretty easily. All right, have a fantastic day, and I'll see you next time.